Good morning. Can you hear me? Thank you, Haitong. Haitong, right? Haitong. Anthony. Thank you, Anthony. Any questions before we formally start? Yeah, I think yesterday we have a very good discussion. You guys ask very good questions. I think I somehow during that moment somehow after the class, you know, usually it's a kind of like my brain is not very clear. So yeah, but anyway, I didn't answer that question very well yesterday. So that's a very good question. Actually, I didn't think about that. I thought I totally understand the stride scheduling and the lottery scheduling, but after you guys asked me question, I really understand those questions, those algorithms now. Before, actually, I thought I understand. Okay, I thought, okay, it's a very simple algorithm and so on. But I never think about when we do the scheduling, what that mean, right? So I think you guys provide a very good question. Say, okay, so when we do scheduling, so do we still have time slice? Then I think that's a very good question. I thought it's, before I just say, oh, you have some percentage CPU usage, that's it. Now how to achieve that goal, right? That's a fundamental question. So after class, I found the original dissertation from MIT about this algorithm. And also, I also found some, actually, we have read some papers use stride scheduling. Recent paper, so I will provide those reference to you guys. If you are interested, then you can read the paper and do some follow up. This is still a research topic after like 20 years. Okay, people still utilize this one to solve the problem. So excellent question. Okay. Today's plan, right? So you guys must realize we have a lab, right? So don't forget the lab. In today's lab, what schedule is usually used nowadays? Oh yeah, I will talk about that schedulers. Okay, what schedulers we use? So basically, we use a multiple level feedback queue. Those kind of type of scheduling. And also, we also use fairness-based. Okay, so generally speaking, both type of scheduler will be provided in an open system. Then it's up to user to select one of them in practice to use. Well, I will talk about that later. Okay, so yeah, I guess we can start. Okay, let's go back to look at one questions we discussed, but we didn't answer it. I didn't answer it very well. So generally speaking, we talked about multiple level feedback queue yesterday, and also proportional sharing, right? So particularly, we introduced lottery scheduling, which is a simple algorithm. Then we talk about some ticket issues, which is kind of similar to the economic course, right? So. Then finally, we talk about some implementation issue. So basically, we introduce one user directly use ticket. Then we also talk about if we directly use the ticket, then it may introduce some unfairness if the job length is short. So we want to make sure the algorithm can be more deterministic. So we talk about stride scheduling. The idea also is very simple. Basically, we introduce a concept called stride. Stride is inversely proportional to a ticket value. Okay. Then each time we will pick up the process with a minimum pass, right? So then do the scheduling. So here, the yesterday question is that, so do we still have a slice, time slice? Of course. So when we schedule a particular process to run, actually that means we will give a quantum, a time slice basically to for this process to run, right? So in reality, it's a little bit more complicated. So if you look at a Linux implementation, then they also provide some bound, maximum time, minimum time. So, but generally speaking, when we schedule a process to run in each pass, that is associated with a time slice. Okay, a quantum, time quantum, right? So basically based on that, we can roughly to guarantee the percentage, CPU percentage, okay? So to answer your question, yes, in each pass, in each run, when we schedule in each pass, when we pick up a process to run, then which is a time slice we offer to this process to run. Then after that, then we pick up next month based on the pass value. Yeah. So we also talk about this issue, right? So if a new job enters into the system, for example, suppose our ABC, those pass value already 2000, then if we have a new job coming to the system, then initial stride value is zero. Then we will schedule E until E reach to 2000, right? So in this case, actually we should, when we set up initial value of E, then we should consider this. For example, we can pick up the minimum pass value, then use that for the new coming task. Oh, at a particular moment, I think some student also mentioned that we may overflow the pass value, right? So at that moment, then we should reset our value, then we restart, okay? So any other questions related to this proportional sharing? Scattering. Okay, sorry. I didn't ask you guys. Can you guys see my screen? See the slides properly?
Yes, yes.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so sometimes I just forget. Let's see. Okay, looks like I don't see any question at this moment, but please input your question, right? So I will after class, I will upload one dissertation from MIT, which is the author to propose those technique, right? Lottery scheduling and stride scheduling. And also, I will provide you another paper from Sigmode last year, Sigmode 2021. Sigmode is one for top conference in database. So in which they utilize thread scheduling for database transaction processing. Okay, I want to show you that although this algorithm has been proposed for more than 20 years, but still people can do research based on that. Okay, yeah. So if you are interested, then you can read the paper. I think this is a very interesting dissertation, very good writing dissertation. I read the dissertation briefly yesterday because you guys gave me the question, right? Provided a good question. So motivate me to read that dissertation again. Okay, so today's topic. Basically, you guys also ask this question. So far, when we talk about scheduling, we assume we only have one processor, or we assume we only have one CPU core. Okay, so nowadays, almost all processors become multi-core. So how to handle multiple processor scheduling? So that's the problem we need to face. Okay, so the background. With the multi-core processor, then we have to handle the multiple process scheduling, right? Generally speaking, multiple CPU core are packed onto a single chip. Now we have multi-core. So we have to handle this, right? So here, just as a motivation to talk about the future thread, right? So adding more CPU does not make an application run faster directly, right? So we have to redesign our application. So one of the common user approach is you introduce a thread. Then inside one program, we have multiple threads. Then each thread can share data code. However, they have their own stack, right? In this way, it's a kind of a lightweight process. Then we can have better parallel. Okay, so we'll talk about that later. But today's topic is more on scheduling. Suppose we have multiple processes or multiple threads, then how to do scheduling? Basically, how to assign a process or thread to a particular CPU to run? Then how to do allocation, how to do scheduling? How long it occupy a particular CPU, then we do reschedule another one, reschedule, right? Before we talk about this, we have a very important computer structure need to be understood. So when we have CPU, in order to speed up the data processing, because memory actually is around, nowadays is around like 50 nanoseconds when we access one data. Generally speaking, the latency is 50 nanoseconds. However, when we do the operation, one clock cycle is around like 0.5 nanosecond or 0.25. One fourth. For example, if your CPU frequency is 4 gigahertz, then so let me just briefly talk about this. If your CPU frequency is 4 gigahertz, for example, okay, which means one instruction cycle is 0.5 nanosecond. Right? Basically, a lot of instruction can be finished in one clock cycle, which is 0.25. nanosecond. Yeah. However, if we want to load our data from memory to register, it takes around 50 nanoseconds. So you can see this is how many times? 200 times difference, right? CPU processing is very fast. However, when we load data into the memory, when we load data into the register onto the CPU, into our register, then this is becomes slow, very slow. Okay, so this is the why when we design our memory hierarchy, we usually have a cache here. Cache is kind of a faster memory. However, we cannot put a lot of cache onto the CPU chip because of the area issue, okay? So anyway, so you can think about this as a faster memory directly reside inside CPU. Then our access time here is from 1 nanosecond to, it depends, okay? Depends whether or not we can hit the cache. If we can directly get the data from cache, then it's around like 1 nanosecond we can get data. Otherwise, we have to go to the memory to get the data, then replace the data inside the cache here. Okay. So, but generally speaking, cache is small, fast memory. Then we can put the popular data into this small area on CPU chip. Because this cache is inside CPU chip, our CPU core and the cache are on the same chip, then basically we can quickly access the data, okay? Certainly we need to utilize temporal locality and spatial locality, okay? Generally speaking, temporal locality means if we access the data once, it's very possible we will access its data later, okay? In recent data, if we access this data, then we may access data again in the future. Generally speaking, that's a time, right? In the time dimension, and basically, we will repeatedly access one data. Spatial locality is more on the space area. So generally speaking is that if we access one memory location, one data in one memory location, it's very possible we will access the data nearby. Okay, space, right? So then utilize this temporal locality and spatial locality, we design our cache mechanism. The idea is that when we access a particular memory location, we want to load data from a particular memory location. We will not only load that, for example, one word, or one double word into the register. We will load one cache line, usually is 64 bytes, 128 bytes, depends on the configuration. But we will load more data, okay? For example, we only access this 4 bytes data in memory, but we will load the whole cache line, which is maybe 64 bytes. Then you can see here, because we use this data, we load this data into a particular cache line, then we satisfy temporal locality. Next time when you access the data, you can go to the cache to get the data, right? Then spatial locality, because when we access this data, we may access the nearby data. So we load the whole cache line into the cache. So it's very possible if we want to access the data nearby, then the data will be in cache. So we have cache hit. So that's a general idea, Okay. So, of course, our mean memory hold all data. However, it's slow, right? So by keep data in cache, the system can make slow memory appear to be a fast one, right? Because we load data. So only first time when we access a particular data, if we don't have that data in cache, we load it into the cache. Then next time when we access the same data, we have benefit from cache. Then if we access the nearby data, we have benefit because it's very possible that data is in cache. So that's the idea. Okay, the problem is that if we have multiple CPU, then each CPU will have his own cache. For example, in this situation, we have two CPU, then we have a share, we have a, each CPU has his own cache, you can see. Then, of course, suppose the memory only contain for data, okay? 0, 1, 2, 3. So then in this situation, CPU zero read the data at address 1, okay? Then through our bus, then we read this data into the cache. Then CPU zero can access the data now through the cache. Does not need to go a long way to go to the memory to access data. Just go to the local cache to get data. Okay, so very fast, great. However, because the data, we have a copy here inside the cache, then CPU one, CPU zero, right? So sorry, CPU zero read this data, right? So CPU zero is here, program here, running on CPU zero, changes the data locally, okay? So for example, the D is changed to D prime right now, okay? Then next step, CPU one want to read the data from memory. Okay, you can see here, if we don't handle this issue, because CPU one say that I will read data from the memory, right? Then it will read the old data, D. However, D has been changed to D prime, okay? Which means you transfer $1 million to my account, right? So it has been changed. But you read the data, you say, oh, yeah, nothing has been changed. Maybe I should give another $1 million to Professor Shao, right? Okay, yeah. So you can see that we have inconsistency here, right? So to handle this issue, basically, we can do bus snooping, the technique. The idea is very simple. So basically, each cache need to pay attention to the memory update by observe the bus. Because think about that. All cache, all CPU I connect through the bus, right? So if I listen the bus, the data, bus means, okay, I transfer data that every CPU can get that data. But if I look at the data, oh, this data is not for me, right? So I will not handle it, right? But I can read the data, right? So basically I can observe the bus. If I find an update for a particular data in my cache, I hold it, for example, in this case, right? So CPU zero already hold this data, right? CPU now update this data. So this CPU zero must inform other people. Say, oh, guys, I have changed D prime, okay? D prime has been changed. Not D prime. D has been changed, okay? If you guys have D in your cache, so remember, okay, you should invalidate that data, okay, if you have, right? So that's a general idea, okay? So basically, it will notice the change and either invalidate his copy or update the data. So in this case, generally speaking, if CPU1 want to read this data, CPU1 know, oh, the data has been changed by CPU0, because when CPU0 update D, CPU0 need to broadcast, I change the value D, okay? Then CPU1 later say, oh, I want to read the D. Then he know, oh, this she know, right? CPU1 know the data has been changed. We should read data from CPU0. So we have a set of protocol to handle this. But generally speaking, we cannot read data from memory. We have to read the data, read the updated data. Either we let CPU0 to update the data or let CPU0 to send this data to us, okay, generally speaking. But you may wonder, okay, so why we care about those things, right? So CPU cache, right? So this hardware mechanism. So who cares? Okay, we are talking about scheduling. So why you want to introduce this concept? So let me skip those shared data structure. I will go back to talk about this. Okay. Basically this is the motivation for our concurrency issue we need to handle. Okay, so cache introduce a major issue called cache affinity. So you think about that. If we run a process on a particular CPU, then we will load a lot of data onto the cache line. Then when we do multiple scheduling, we should keep a process on the same CPU as much as possible. Otherwise, you think about, okay, if a process running on CPU zero, then I load a lot of data. In the beginning, I load a lot of data, warm up my cache, right? So a lot of data are in cache line. Now I'm happily process data from the cache. However, after rescheduling, you schedule this process into CPU one, right? Think about that. Then I have to warm up this CPU one's cache again, because a lot of data are not in cache. So I have to warm up. Then you reschedule this to another process, to another CPU, right? So this make our performance become very bad. Okay, so generally speaking, a process build up a lot of states in the cache for a particular CPU. So when next time when this process run, it will run faster if some of its states is already preserved in the cache on that CPU. Okay, this we associate a particular CPU to a particular to associate a particular process to a particular CPU in order to utilize the warm-up cache called cache affinity. Okay. So basically, a multiple processor scheduler should consider cache affinity when making his scheduling decision. Now, how to do that? The question is, okay, so this answer one student question, how to do multi-processor scheduling. Okay, so the first intuitively solution may be a naive, or we call it naive solution, right? Usually we have baseline, right? So then we will consider this cache affinity. We maintain a queue, it's similar to our previous case. We have a centralized queue. Then when process come in, we just put all process onto this queue. Then follow our algorithm to do the scheduling. But we consider the cache affinity. For example, let's look at if we don't consider cache affinity, what happened? Okay. Then you can see if we don't consider cache affinity, then if we simply pick up the next job from the global shared queue, for example, here. Okay. Then this cache, we may have this kind of a situation. You can see A will schedule in the beginning, A schedule here. Then because we have A, B, C, D, E, right? So we schedule A, B, C, D, then stop. Times less, we do scheduling again based on the, looks like here, it's kind of based on a round robin way. So we do E, A, B, C somehow. So you can see here, because we don't have cache affinity, then this is very slow. Every time when we run a new process, this new process need to warm up this cache. Okay, again, again, right? So, of course, a better approach is that we can preserve affinity, okay? So now we will see that, oh, if A is scheduled on CPU zero, then we will try our best to schedule A on the same CPU, okay? Similarly for B, C, D, right? Then E can be, if we don't have enough physical CPU, then E can be alternative A, scheduled to different CPU, okay? However, implementation for this kind of scheme is complicated, okay? So I think about that. We have to contain a lot of information. For example, previously, this process is scheduled on which CPU? Then next time when we do scheduling, we have to say that, oh, we prefer this CPU, however, this CPU is occupied, then we have to make a decision whether we schedule this to another processor or we don't, right? So it's complicated when we have a single queue, when we have a lot of processes, actually, if we want to implement this kind of scheme, it is complicated. Then you can see our solution is very simple. We can have multiple queue, multiple process scheduling. So here you can see that actually in operating system, we prefer simple algorithm, okay? So the idea is very simple. We have multiple scheduling queue, then each queue will follow a particular scheduling discipline. For example, each queue can follow multiple level feedback queue or proportional sharing, those kind of approach, lottery, stride, whatever, okay? Then when a job enters the system, it plays on exactly one scheduling queue. So which means you can see that basically we will map. So generally speaking, each queue, each CPU, CPU one have one queue, CPU two has one queue, okay? So we already assigned one queue here. Then when a process coming, then we will say, oh, you should go here, you should go here. Usually we use a round robin manner, right? Then put into the different queue. Then in each queue, we'll do scheduling, follow our approach. For example, multiple level feedback queue, okay? Then in this way, actually, we don't need to keep the global information about the process states. So because we already put this task onto a particular queue, that means you are associated with this queue. Then you can now move, generally speaking, US schedule on SCP. Okay, however, we do have some exception. Okay, I will talk about later, but generally speaking, this is bound with a particular CPU. Then in this way, we can maintain cache affinity because see this process already fixed on this CPU, then definitely the cache affinity has been satisfied. To give an example, in the beginning, we have Q0, which associated with CPU 0, Q1 is associated with CPU 1. So this must be fixed in the beginning. Then when we have a process, then we will put those processes into a particular queue, use a round robin manner. It's here just like the first time go to Q0, the next time Q1. Now if we have multiple, just do it, right? Round robin manner. This is scalability is very good. You think about that. No matter how many CPU core we have, then if we have N CPU, we have N queues, then for if we change this number N, then we just add another queue, right? Then associate this queue with a particular CPU and we finish. Cache affinity can be satisfied because a particular process must be scheduled on a particular CPU. Okay, then we finish. So that's great, okay? Then for each queue, we can have scheduling strategy. We may have different strategy, but usually we have the same scheduling strategy in your system. For the different queue, we have same strategy. For example, multiple level feedback queue that can be applied. Yeah, that's it. We finish, right? So you think about this solution is that based on our single processor scheduling, we simplify the problem here. For each CPU, we have a queue. Then process I place onto a particular queue in a round robin manner. Then for each queue, and you just do the scheduling, right, based on the strategy we used. Then all single processor scheduling strategy can be applied on this single queue and we finish the job. I hope this is clear. Is this clear? Okay, maybe I will answer some question later, okay? Okay, so we may have a load imbalance issue, right? So for example, in this case, in the beginning we have A running in Q0, then in Q1 we have B and D, okay? Then this is imbalanced, right? Then the reason maybe is in the beginning we have A and C. However, some process finish earlier, some process is only running very short time, okay, finish. But B and D happen along running processes, similar A also A. In this case, you can see A will, Q0 is very lightweight here. Load is light. Then B and D will alternatively utilize CPU1. It's okay because if you load D into Q0, maybe we have similar issue, but some situation may happen is that Q0 is totally empty. However, we fixed B and D on Q1, right? Then under this situation, because we fixed the B and D on Q1, all process on Q1 will be scheduled on CPU1. So, sorry, we cannot do anything. Although a CPU is idle, but we will schedule BND on CPU. Okay, that's an issue. Then how to handle this? Okay, generally speaking, we can do the migration. For example, under this situation, the operating system look at, oh, Q0 is empty. The Q1 we still have two processes. Then we should migrate a process from Q1 to Q0, for example, in this case, right? Oh, we migrate B, right? But generally speaking, we want to make it a balance, right? The situation is this may cause some situation we call throttle, right? So in the beginning, we look at, oh, this is not balanced. We load B. Then later we find out, oh, this, for example, in this case, here we have one process, here we have two. Then we move B into Q0, right? Then schedule like this. Then later we'll find, hey, Q0 now is not, it's more heavy, okay? We move A back, okay? So basically we will do this kind of migration frequently, okay? Of course, migration is not free. So it's costly because when you move a process from one CPU to another CPU, you have to warm up your cache and so on. So this kind of a migration may not be frequently executed. So general approach is called work stealing, okay? So we move job between the queue. The implementation is that, so we pick up a source queue, okay? So we find out we don't have enough job here. So we pick up this source one. Then this source queue occasionally peak at another target queue. So basically source queue will be initiator, look at, okay? So we first pick up a source queue, then this queue say that I will look at other queues workload, okay? Then if a particular target queue is more heavy, too heavy, okay? Then we can steal one or more jobs from target queue, okay? So of course, we have, when we do this, we have a high overhead, but generally speaking, that's the strategy we use in reality. Okay, in practice, we use work stealing to do it. Okay, so let me finish today's lecture. Then maybe we can discuss. We can have some discussion. Right. So I think you guys ask a very good question in the beginning. Say that in reality, what kind of scheduling strategy we use, right? So this is why we want to study the concept. You can see that the both technique we introduced will be used in practice. In Linux, actually, it provides several schedulers. The first one called O1, order one. So this is the idea is totally based on our multiple level feedback queue. Of course, for different system, it may have a different flavor to implement multiple level feedback queue. But you can see here, we have priority based scheduler, use a multiple level queue, change your process priority over time, schedule process with the highest priority, interactivity is a particular focus, okay? So Linux implementation actually is even simpler. They don't have the allotment. So basically if a process give up CPU before the allocated time slice, it can be kept on the highest priority queue. Yeah, so actually there are some research paper talk about this, okay, how to improve this kind of stuff. Yeah. So, but anyway, order one is one of, order one scheduler is one of a popular and commonly used scheduler, okay, in Linux. Linux also provide two more scheduler based on our proportional sharing, consider the fairness, okay? So one is completely fair scheduler, okay? This is very similar to our stride scheduling, okay? Another one is BFS, okay? This is also used very common. It's a new one. Use a single queue proportional sharing based on virtual time, virtual deadline first, and so on. Okay. So, but the concept wise, this is a proportional sharing. This also is a proportional sharing. So, if you guys are interested, then you can look at the document related. Okay. So, let me conclude today's lecture. So, basically today I finished the CPU scheduling. Actually we started this topic yesterday, right? Last week. Okay. So we introduced a scheduling matrix. In the beginning, we talk about turnaround time, response time. Then later we talk about fairness. Okay. The scheduling strategy, we introduce a simple one, for example, faithful sausage job first and so on, right? Round robin, then we go to the multiple level feedback queue. This is the one for most important one in related to your homework, okay? So in assignment three, on paper, you need to finish a schedule based on multiple level feedback queue, okay? Which is very similar to the question discussed by the tutor today, okay? Of course, we also have a bonus program assignment related to multiple level feedback queue, for which the tutor will introduce a tutorial and provide some basic structure for you. So you can utilize those basic structure and the basic implementation. So tutor will implement this one, faithful, right? Then you, based on this implementation, then you can implement a multiple level feedback queue. For the bonus assignment. So we also introduced proportional sharing, so in which we talk about lottery scheduling and also stride scheduling. Right? Today, we mainly talk about multiple process scheduling. Basically, we talk about cache coherence. We talk about this issue, then cache affinity, then we introduce several techniques, single queue, multi queue, and a load balance. Okay. So next, we'll talk about memory. So that's all for today's lecture. I think the time is almost 12:15. Perfect, right? So as usual, we will go to the Q&A session. If you want to stay, then you can stay here. Then, yeah. Then if you have a other issue that you can emergent stuff, right? So you can leave now. The lecture has to be finished. Okay, let me copy the questions. Then I will go back to also some questions here. Yeah, first let me share the whiteboard. Yeah, what is so the first question, In Ho Kim asked, what is an example of popular data, right? So popular data is a kind of, you know, so we don't define, we don't have a definition for popular data. Actually, based on the cache, based on the memory access, based on the memory access, we will automatic the actually the, our hardware, the CPU and the cache. Well, move a bunch of data into the cache line. Okay, so that data, that bunch of data, this is not, of course, this dot, this data include the data we access. We want to access, but not only that data, we will access the bunk data into the cache line. So for example, our data we want to access, suppose, okay, it's a one integer, right? For example, right, this is four bytes, suppose, okay? However, we will move a bunk of data, which is, into a cache line. Cache line actually is, it depends on the configuration. It may be like 64 bytes or something like that, right? So this bunk of data is popular, right? At this time, it's popular data, okay? At this time, okay? So in other words, all data in cache line, we think they are popular. So we put this into the cache line. So hopefully we will access those data later. Okay, but if we don't access data, then based on some cache replacement policy, then we will evict those data from the cache, okay? Yeah, so execution time, stealing the jobs. Okay, I don't understand those questions. Maybe I didn't copy the question, but for Yinso, is this okay for your popular data question? Okay, yeah. So let me copy some more question, yeah. Hopefully I can copy successfully. Clean. Yeah, somehow I could not copy those questions. So what happened? So maybe let me directly answer the question. Okay. I know you guys cannot, maybe you guys can go to the chat box, right? So I'm going to talk about one line change question. But different process may have different execution time. Exactly, right? So Wang Kim, this is a very good question. Okay, so we can, this may cause load imbalance, right? It can be solved by work stealing, right? So another CPU does not know you take the, of course, we have to handle this, right? If we don't do coordination, then we may have some situation here, right? So definitely when we do the migration, usually we should have more processes in one queue, then we just use some way to move that. Then of course another CPU should realize, okay, now this job has been moved to another queue, right? Because that's queue operation, right? So definitely when we do the migration, we should lock the queue. Then after we move to another queue successfully, then we remove this from the queue, right? So something like that. But if we don't do this kind of a coordination, definitely we cannot do that. Okay, so any other questions? Hello guys, any other questions? Okay, then please attend today's lab. which is very important for you to, which is very important for you to finish assignment one. Of course, if you look at the tutorial slides and you feel comfortable, then it's okay. Yeah. But anyway, okay. So tutor prepare very good material. Okay. I really like those material. So I may utilize that a little bit the next time, next week. Okay. So that's all for today. Thank you. See you next week. Stay safe and healthy.